Buongiorno, Soraya.
Buongiorno.
Welcome back from Italy.
Thank you.
You had a good time in Rome?
I had a fantastic time. Thank you.
And now you're ready to get back to podcasting?
I think so.
Well, I've been wanting to talk about the Long Ryders for quite a while, and we have an opportunity today to discuss their new album.
I think that's awesome.
And we have a special guest.
Yes, we do.
So let's get started.
Sounds good. Hi, this is Soraya.
And this is Jeff.
Our podcast is called Paisley Stage Raspberry and Rhyme.
A podcast where the two of us play music that we like and share anecdotes and background about the tunes.
We hope you'll join our conversation. And without further ado, agrubiar.
Let's get groovy. Okay, so today on our podcast, we're going to be talking to longtime Long Ryders drummer, Greg Sowders.
Isn't that cool?
That's so cool. I'm so excited.
It's going to be awesome.
Yeah.
You know they have a new album coming out.
Yes. Can you believe it?
Yes. So, in a day and age of 3x4, where we're getting some new takes on tunes, I'm excited to hear that these really cool bands are giving us new music.
That's so
cool. So yes, I believe it. I'm a believer.
You are a believer. All right, well, let's give Greg a call.
Hello?
Hello, Greg. It's Jeff and Soraya.
Hey there.
So good to hear your voice, Greg.
Well, it's good to talk to you guys. I'm pretty stoked that you called me. Thank you.
So today on our show, Soraya, as we mentioned, we have Greg Sowders, the drummer from the Long Ryders, and we're going to be talking about their new album, Psychedelic Country Soul.
So excited to talk about this.
Yes. Thank you, Greg, for joining our call.
Well, it's my pleasure. We're really excited to talk about this new record. As you guys know, it's been a long time coming, and I know that you guys and your show have always been really supportive to the Long Ryders and bands that play music like we do, so it's cool to be able to join you both.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. So the release date is coming up, February the 15th, and yeah, it has been a bit, you know, it has been a minute since we've had a studio album from the Long Ryders, the last one being Two-Fisted Tales. Can you talk to us a little bit about, you know, what inspired you guys to get back into the studio and give us some new music?
For sure. Well, over the years, I mean, we played together in the 80s when you guys all knew us, and we split up for a while. Everybody kind of went their separate ways, and kind of in the early 2000s, maybe 2002 or 3, something like that, we started playing shows together again because we really missed each other, and we felt like we hadn't finished everything that we wanted to do. And it kind of picked up some momentum. Every couple of years, we'd play shows, and we were really happy and surprised how many people wanted to see us. And then Sid Griffin always reissued our records over in England on his Prima Records label. And then there were live records and extra tracks. And we had a box set that came out a couple of years ago outside the U.S. that was really fun. And everybody was really enjoying playing together. So we got together kind of separately, one of those write a song, you know, over email kind of vibe. Steven and I worked a little bit on a Tom song called Bear in the Woods, and that came out about a year ago, and it was really fun. Just when it seemed to fall into place, your future just been sold. The key no longer fits that lock. You feel dangerous. Yeah.
a sight to behold with this whole family.
Well, look, everybody's been writing. We haven't finished our thoughts as the Long Ryders. We're, you know, back together. Let's see what we can do all in the same room. And like you may have read, we had a mutual friend, a guy named Larry Chapman, who worked with Dr. Dre, and he worked with our band, played with us for a while at the end. He's a co-owner in a cool old studio, used to be called Record One out here, and Los Angeles, and big old live room, and Dre used it, but he only made hip-hop records there, so they invited us to come out, and we showed up with a bunch of songs and really kind of learned them in the studio, and all the guys, Tom and Sid and Steven, had really saved up some terrific Long Rider kind of songs. They didn't really sound like the songs they make on their own, and we figured it out, and we brought our old pal Ed Stasium in, and zero pressure, because no one really cares until it's here. It's been so long, and suddenly everybody was really happy and excited. So we finished the record in about 10 days.
Wow. That's crazy. Mm-hmm. So you said with Bear in the Woods that you were doing it over email. On Psychedelic Country Soul, the new record, did Sid and Steven send you guys demos, and then you work on them at home and then got together in the room? Or how did that work with the new songs?
So we did pass around some demos, you know, in this great modern era that we all live in. They sent some rough files back and forth. And one thing we learned when we did Bear in the Woods, and we did another Steven song, an unreleased song called Down to the Well that you'll get to hear one day. It's cool to have a couple guys in the room, but there's a reason we had a band, the Long Ryders. The dynamic and the vibe is different when all four of us are there. You know, sometimes everybody's really happy and excited. Other days, everybody's really grumpy. But, you know, that's what makes great rock and roll, you know, camaraderie and friction. So we had these rough demos just to understand tempo and things like that. But we all got in the room and it changed. And we cut mostly everything live and then went back and overdubbed things that needed it. So there's just, and you guys love live music and love bands. So, you know, there's just a magic that happens when everybody's looking at each other across the room and really playing, and it's warts and all, but it's just a better experience.
Yeah, we love that.
I'd have to agree with you. And, you know, I just want to delve just a little bit further into the recording process, because I just love the story of how this project really came to be with the involvement of Larry Chapman. And I just wanted to know, what's the connection between the band and Larry Chapman? You mentioned that, you know, it was a friend, but has it been over time? And then also just a follow-up, how was it recording in the studio that's produced, you know, different types of hits in that studio?
Pretty wild. So Larry was in the early days of the Long Riders, in the sort of early 80s, everybody kind of the hub, the Long Rider house, was Sid Griffin's pad in West Hollywood out here in California. And there was all kinds of characters moving around there. You know, the Bangles were always around, and Dream Syndicate guys, and Eric Burden used to sleep on Sid's couch, and Billy Bremner from Rockpile. That was crazy. So there was just, you never knew who was going to be around. And Larry was a friend of Sid's roommates from Chicago. Great bass player. He'd done some work with George Clinton and Parliament Funkadelic.
Wow.
And was really mostly, I mean, probably a better musician than all of us put together, but was working on the road more as a tech. So he did a couple tours as a guitar tech for us. And our last U.S. tour, Tom Stevens had left the band. And, you know, we were just trying to keep it together and duct tape and, you know, and staples and everything. So Larry, we asked him if he played bass for us, and he said, sure. And then being a, every rock and roll band, man, we're, everything's so flaky. We said, cool, Larry, you're in the band, but can you also take our van and drive it from L.A. to Richmond, Virginia for us, and we'll fly and meet you there.
Oh, my God.
So, yeah, right. So he said, okay, cool. And we flipped him a cassette, said, by the way, learn all these songs. So we showed up in Richmond, I think it was Richmond, and we got on stage, and of course, Larry didn't learn a single song.
Uh-oh.
Because he was so pissed off at us for making him drive the van that he decided to teach us a lesson. So we got up on stage, and, you know, great musician, but he just looked at us like, that's what happened, fellas. So we kind of figured it out, and he ended up doing this tour, and then, you know, musicians stay in touch with each other. It's good to be friends and stay loyal. So he had hooked up with Dr. Dre on their very first tour, Dre, I just post NWA. And he and Dre got to be friends, and he started doing everything for Dre, personal assistant, studio assistant. And when Dre bought this studio, it used to be Val Garay's studio, he went into partnership with Larry and gave him half the studio. I've been giving him the whole studio. And so when we got there, there were these giant SSL boards to make hip-hop records, and nobody used in the live room. There's a bunch of stuff stored up in there, so they moved all the boxes out, and I don't think they'd ever seen live drums or amps. Or they never had to, you know, use 30 or 40 mic lines in. You know, they were freaked. Dre was amazed. He's like, what the, you know? And we just got down, man, and that old room, there's a lot of those old rooms that are around, and the way people make records now, they're not as popular. So you can't substitute a big old wood room that just bleeds and soaks it up. And, you know, they made all kinds of big records in the 80s and the 70s there. And, you know, it was just the right place for us to get down.
Wow. So was Dre present during the recording?
He was around a lot, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, he'd come in and kind of hang out and talk to us. And, you know, my day job, I'm a music publisher. And, you know, the company I work for, we work with Dre, so I knew him a little bit professionally. But, you know, it's different when you connect with people musically. It's just better. And so it was fun to be in a room with a guy who's had such success and just talk about making records. And, you know, the guy's brilliant. What can you say? Whatever the genre, man, the guy is brilliant.
Yeah, for sure.
Fantastic.
That's incredible. Hey, so you mentioned that the production duties were handled by Ed Stasium, who you guys worked with on Two Fisted Tales, right? And he's worked with the Ramones, Mick Jagger, Talking Heads, Translator, Motorhead, Living Color, Smithereens, Peter Wolf, all kinds of people. So how was it working with him again after all these years?
Truly an old master. And when we met Ed early on, we hired him because when we made Two Fisted Tales, I mean, we worked with some cool people. We worked with Earl Mankey, who I know you guys know because of 3 o'clock records.
Right.
And we worked with Henry Louie, who made the original Flying Burrito Brothers records, and Joni Mitchell and Mamas and Papas, you know, the real deal. And so Ed, because besides our influences, you know, 60s psychedelic and all that kind of stuff, you know, the Ramones and what happened in the sort of mid and late 70s was a big influence on us, because that was the through line from Ramones to eventually X and Blasters. All those groups really mattered to us. So especially for me, because I was a couple years younger than the other fellows, that sound was important as a young drummer. So Ed was the architect of that Ramones sound, you know, simplicity and energy. So we met him, and it was cool, and he, like, invited us down to a Mick Jagger session in New York at his old studio. I can't remember. It might have been Power Plant or Record Plant, one of those New York joints. And, it, you know, we're kids, and there's Mick Jagger and Ed Stacey, and we're like, okay, cool, we'll do this.
Wow.
And he just was a guy that always is in search of the vibe and the groove and was really supportive. I think Ed taught me more about playing drums than anybody else.
Oh, my God.
He could sing. He could play. He was one of us, man. And so we I think Two Fits of Tales is all of the band's what just about our favorite record. It may not have been the most popular, but we loved it. So we stayed in touch with Ed, and Sid made Cole Porter's records with Ed. It just felt like the right fit to do this thing. We kind of call him the fifth Long Rider. It's probably a tie, Larry and Ed. There's two fifth Long Riders, you know? So anyway, he got us together, and, you know, anytime we'd hit a speed bump or, you know, somebody had an old grudge that popped up or somebody couldn't find the path to the part, Ed was right there, and the guy is just the king, man.
Wow.
And, you know, now that we're talking about these bridges, you know, between, you know, friends and people kind of coming back and helping out with this record, according to press, the Bangles have provided vocals to this record as well. Can you talk to us a little bit about their involvement and how that came about? Was that just organic or?
Yeah, sure. So we know the girls for a long time. Like I said, Debbie used to live at Sid's house, that same house. You know, like I said, Eric Burden would be on the couch. Billy Bremner would be in the kitchen drinking a beer, and Debbie would be off tour, you know, renting out the back bedroom, and it was that kind of stuff. And so we were all big fans. Obviously, when the Bangs were going, that was great. And the Bangles, you know, to see local friends have such success, we were always so proud of them. And so we stayed in touch, and some of their crew, their sound people, have always worked for the Long Riders when we would tour. So we had a couple songs that we knew. Their harmonies are incredible. No one sings like them. And so on a song that Tom Stevens wrote called Let It Fly, it's kind of folky and kind of a groove. There was a lot of parts for you know, big soaring harmony, and especially female harmony. So we asked them if they would come and sing, and they arranged their own parts, and they were amazing. And then while they were there, on the new record, there's a cover of a Tom Petty song. We all love Tom Petty, called Walls.
Great song.
It's from one of his soundtracks he worked on. So we decided we wanted to play that song and record it for Tom, to remember Tom. And we asked him to sing on that, too. So on Tom's record, I think Lindsey Buckingham sings on it. So they, of course, crushed it, and we were super grateful. So really a long, long-term friendship. And, they always have told us they liked our music, which is flattering, but we really respect them. It's like, would you please sing on our record? It's your voice. You know. Cool.
That's awesome. The first single from the new record is Stevens' Greenville track, which we absolutely love. It's a fantastic song.
Excellent, yeah.
Here we go.
Straight out of New Orleans, left in a hurry, trying to make some time. Punch a ticket and take me down the line. Ooh, you need to know. Down to Mobile. Take me down to you. They threw me in the pen. That's why I'm never going back again. Yes, I am a dreamer.
Idea was to release it as the first single.
That's right. It just kind of felt like a good place to start the record. You know, Long Ryders are a rock and roll band, really, and it felt like it kind of, even though we're a fiercely, you know, American rock and roll band, we all loved, you know, the Rolling Stones and things like that. So for me, it always reminds me of that kind of, you know, Brown Sugar sort of four on the floor groove. And and the lyric is a contemporary, you know, all of us pay attention to all the chaos and insanity in the news. And the Long Ryders have always tried to have a little bit of a narrative about what's going on here in the U.S., and especially because we did so much time on the road. So the lyric is kind of Stephen's thoughts on what's been going on. And it kind of felt like a good thing to connect that Bear in the Woods song, just sound-wise, and move into this record. This record has a lot of different colors and textures to it. This was one of the rockers, and yeah, the radio guys have been playing it. SiriusXM, you know, their outlaw country station, which is a nice, it's hard to find a national place to play music that we do, and they've been incredibly kind to us. So yeah, man, that's felt like a good place to let everybody know that this is a new record from a bunch of old guys.
That can still rock.
No, that do
so.
Rock.
Thank you.
That do rock.
Yeah.
I like it.
And in talking about, you know, the rock and roll life and the rock and roll band, it was really interesting for us to find out that rock photographer Henry Diltz was present during the recording to document the sessions. How was it working with really this you know, icon of not just the rock scene, but of the photography scene, the art scene?
We love Henry. We're fortunate. We consider him a friend, you know, a really a good, dear brother, big brother. And we met him. I mean, we all knew his work because he took some of the most important and iconic pictures of music pictures of our time and just cultural pictures. And, you know, we got to meet him in probably the mid-80s. He took some pictures for us and did some, I think some EP sleeves that came out in the UK. And then that box set that we were talking about a little bit earlier, the photo on the cover of that, it's called Final Wild Sons.
Right.
He took that photo, which was a favorite for us. We felt like it really always kind of summed up, you know, just our feel about how the band is. And so he, you know, he just would show up. He took some pictures at some local shows for us again. And because I'm here in LA, you know, the other fellows are all over the place. We've been friendly for now a long time. So I asked Henry if he would come down and take some pictures. And a gentleman he is. He's like, of course. So we hung out for the day. And when it came time to do an album cover, Long Ryders are notoriously bad at figuring out album covers. And if you guys know anything about production and stuff, that you got it takes a minute. And, you know, bands are lazy or confused or you can't decide. So we waited. And then we started putting stuff together and everything looked just ridiculous. And so we went to these Henry pictures. Henry knows just, he knows how to take pictures. There's a certain way to take a picture of a band and have you not look too foolish or like convicts. And so he took this picture and suddenly it just felt like as we looked at all our album covers, you know, you kind of fall into a thing. And it turns out we've had a lot of albums with us on the front. And at first we were trying to get it so, you know, we were, it was in the shadows or more conceptual. And we said, look, this is a warts and all. This is what four guys that have been together a long time, this is what you look like now. And Henry's really good at that. So we kind of liked his shot. It was kind of stark and just right on.
That's so cool.
He is the best, man.
Yeah. Yeah, you can't get much better than that, right?
No.
So you guys are going to be touring in April, and you'll be playing several shows in Europe, including the UK, Netherlands, Sweden, Norway, Finland, Italy. And we've been personally anxiously awaiting announcement for dates in the U.S., which we understand could be coming for possible shows in the fall.
Yes, you guys are right. I can assure you that we will be in the States. We're going to play a proper tour. It feels like it's going to be September. And, you know, it's always a lot of moving parts to get it together. And because Sid lives in London and Tom Stevens lives in Indiana and Stephen McCarthy's in Virginia and I'm still the L.A. guy, you know, it just takes some preparation. And but we're all committed and I'm happy to say that there's plenty of places that want us to come and play, which is, I mean, there's no point in doing some if you guys aren't there to see us.
And we'll be there.
It's been terrific. Yeah, the last time we played here was a couple years ago. We played in Los Angeles. Well, we played all over East Coast and West Coast, but we played a show in Los Angeles at the Roxy Theater, and then we did that Stagecoach Festival. So just working on a couple things that I think will surprise everybody, and we'll be super available for anybody that wants to see us to get up close and, you know, touch the hem of the garment of alt-country pioneers, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
That's right.
We're just really excited about this new record, and one of the things I wanted to mention, especially to our listeners, is so the new record is being released in the UK by Cherry Red Records. So they're releasing a vinyl version and a CD version. And in the US, it's being released on CD and digital format by one of our favorite labels, you know, especially as fans, Omnivore Recordings. And we're just curious. We'd like to know how the band decided to go with Omnivore for the release.
Absolutely. So Cherry Red, we obviously have a long-standing relationship with them, and they put out a lot of music, digital, CD, vinyl, and it's been really good. They've been really good to us, and it's very hard to say that for a band like us to have that relationship. But here in the U.S., it's important, even the way the everything's pretty global now, and releases are simpler to make international, but there's still, you kind of need boots on the ground and people that understand genres and territories. So Omnivore, just like you guys, we're big fans of their catalog. But the three principals, a guy named Greg Allen, who did the art design for the new record and put the album cover together, the Henry Dilts shot, and also took a lot of Long Ryders photos over the years before he started Omnivore. So he's an old pal. Shel Pawelski, who's the co-owner and kind of the, you know, major domo over there, she's always been a Long Ryders fan. And then their third partner is a guy named Brad Rosenberger, who's a great music fan and friend to artists everywhere. And just as trivia, whatever you want to call it, he's the guy that hired me to Warner Chappell Music. He was my first music publishing boss.
Oh, wow.
So, yeah, he hired me. I didn't know anything about business. I was a drummer, and I went in for an interview. I wore a suit. It was the only suit I had. I really had to get it together. And ironically, his boss said, I'm never going to hire a creative guy that wore a suit. And Brad said, well, give him a break. He's a drummer. He probably has the only suit he's got. So I almost didn't get the job because I was overdressed, which would have been hilarious.
Oh, my God.
But Brad asked me about Beach Boys B-sides, and we talked about Doug Somm, and he hired me. And I said, I can't freaking believe that somebody in the music business actually cares about music, because, you know, every band has such bitter experience.
Right.
And he was great. We worked together for many, many years, more than 20 years, and been friends. So when this record shaped up, I called him. I said, look, I'm not sure if this is going to work for both of us, but can I play it for you? And he and Cheryl and Greg Allen were so supportive. They loved it. So we said, let's do it. And, so they're holding down the U.S., North America, whatever you call it, part of the show. So we're really proud to work with Omnivore and Cherry Red. They're really artist-first people.
Wow, that's great.
It's excellent to hear.
And remember, we started out working with, you know, cool indie labels and then Chris Blackwell at Island Records. So we did have the opportunity to work with some pretty interesting record people over time. So for us to, you know, make any kind of new deal, it had to be people that we admire what they're up to.
That is so cool. We're so excited for this new record. Soraya and I have only heard a couple songs, the single, Greenville, and then also Molly Somebody, which is one of Sid's songs. Right. We love that song as well.
Yes.
Like a star, when all the colors were gone, I knew her face in the dark, before the light of the dawn. Molly, somebody's calling out your name, I think it's me. Molly, somebody's calling out your name. Secrets we hold, like a map once read them torn. I knew my way to a door before I ever was born. Molly, somebody's calling out your name. I think it's me. I think it's me. I think it's me. Molly, somebody's calling out your name, Molly, somebody. To rest here in the cold, she waits as I play a role. I turn hearing her call. She knows the key to my soul. Molly, somebody's
that song is one of my favorites too. To me, it feels like a really classic Long Ryders, because that has some of that kind of, some of the influences of the records we listened to in the 60s, kind of the moody minor key stuff. Mm-hmm. I think the actual musicianship on everybody plays with it. We've been playing a long time now, so it's cool. And Sid sang it great, but he collaborated on that song. I'm not sure who did what. I think maybe they collaborated lyrically or something, but our friend Steve Barton from Translator is the co-writer on that song.
Oh, is that right? Wow.
Yeah, it's pretty cool, because usually Sid would only write with Tom or Steve. Really, we didn't write together very much. We would learn songs together. But those guys, Tom and Steven and Sid, kind of finished some of each other's songs on this record. Ironically, for all the years we lived together, this one we were all apart, but they swapped lyrics back and forth and really collaborated. And then because of that last U.S. Or West Coast run a couple of years ago, we played with Translator.
Yeah.
Sid and Steve decided to write the song. I think the same thing. I think they just wrote emails back and forth. And then again at Warner Chappell Music, where Brad Rosenberger for Omnivore was working, Steve Barton worked there with us for a long time. So you had all these musicians and creative people that were doing, day jobs. And so Steve and I had, that's how the tour happened. We were working together. So let's try to make something happen.
Wow. That's so cool. I had no idea that they wrote together on that.
Yeah, it's kind of a nice little surprise. And they are, Steve has always been kind of into that British trip, and Sid is defiantly, sort of American sounding in the way he writes and performs. But they found some common ground and, like I said, wrote a song I really like.
Yeah, it's a great one.
It's fantastic.
So, Greg, we want to also talk about the reissue. So last year the band put out two different 3-CD sets, one for State of Our Union and one for Two Fisted Tales. And like you mentioned before, you worked with Cherry Red Records on those. And both of those sets have bonus tracks, demos, live recordings, and even really cool booklets and fold-out posters in the CDs, which is really cool. State of Our Union has probably my favorite Long Ryder song, Lights of Downtown. How did...
thanks, man. That's cool.
Pack my bags, pack it in. Never coming back here again. Paid my dues and stayed in line. 16 years to serve my time. Now what I did, I do regret. All the days that I had wept, up all night, and you can bet I've gotta live with that. See the lights in downtown, where I shot that old man down. Now that he's calling me, calls my insanity. Now when I walk and people say, how could he just walk away? Had a gun, no daughter, no son. One life is gone and one begun. Now what I did, I do regret. All the days that I had wept, up all night, and you can bet I've gotta live with that. See the lights in downtown, where I shot that old man down. I can't run away, I can't hide. It's a slow death for me inside. We'll be right back.
That's a great song. So how did those box sets come together?
Well, I'll tell you, again, because before we made this new record, we really had a business of being trying to make sure our music was available for our fans and to, you know, curate and take care of it. Because sometimes older bands, they're, if they have a body of work, it falls into disrepair and disappears, or who knows. And Sid, because Sid's a good record man. He pretty much been a cool label. And so he always cared about making sure the stuff got out there. But as fans, all of us always felt like, you just don't want to keep reissuing the same stuff over and over. You got to do something different. And Tom Stevens has really been the band archivist. He saves everything we record. He catalogs it. He has one of those psycho photographic memories. And he also is an audiophile, so he keeps the recordings and can clean them up and, you know, not really remix, but just make sure they sound right and how to release them. So whenever we would get ready to do something, he and Sid would get together and talk about what it should look like and feel like. And early on it was Prima, but really more recently, the Cherry Red people, who are really, I think, really great at doing reissues.
They
kept putting together these ideas from the box set through these two reissues. And surprisingly, there's a lot of material. There's demos from different studios. There's songs that never made it to album. And that's half our story. The studio, the other half, maybe even a bigger piece of it, is our live work. And the Long Ryders were always a live band. We first, last, and always. And even when we weren't making records, we played shows through the 2000s, early 2000s. And I think everybody has always been exciting and a good musician. So we wanted to make sure that the fans and people that cared could hear some of these shows that were really fun back then. And people that were there, they remember them, they connect. I collect live records from the bands I loved, and there are moments in time and they connect you to a feel and a place and what was going on in your life. And they're great. So Cherry Red gave us a long runway to put these together. I think they came out pretty good. The live stuff's pretty exciting, a lot of it.
Yeah, it's great. We love them.
And, you know, now that we're talking about live performances, Jeff and I wanted to pick your brain just a little, and talk about those, that early 80s LA scene. Where bands like Long Ryders, Green on Red, Dream Syndicate, Rain Parade, 3 o'clock Bangles, where you were all kind of in this scene. And we were wondering if you have any recollections or any stories you wish to share about playing together. And correct us if we're wrong, but Steve Wynn was in the Long Ryders
So the Long Ryders formed when Sid Griffin broke up or quit. I don't know. He had a band called Unclaimed that was kind of like a 60s retro psychedelic band in Los Angeles. And, you know, Sid and Steve knew each other, and they both worked at Rhino Records at one point. And so I'm not sure if it was the chicken or the egg, but I know that Steve was trying to start bands and Sid was trying to start this new group. And he had a guy named Barry Shank, who was also in the Unclaimed, the bass player. And they started playing together, and Steve was playing with them. I guess they were writing some songs. And I didn't really know Steve. I knew Sid from the Unclaimed. I was in a ska band called the Box Boys, which was the first LA ska band. It was fun.
Wow.
And I left that band. And so a mutual friend, a guy named Gary Stewart, who was a big-time early guy at Rhino Records, he put me in touch with Sid, and I came and auditioned, and it was cool. But I think Steve Wynn had just stopped playing. I think he decided he wanted to do his own thing, write all the songs. So they rehearsed. They didn't play shows, but they had rehearsed some. I don't know if there's any recordings of that, but that's our relationship with Steve is a long time. And then we got Stephen McCarthy, you know, and took a little more of a kind of psychedelic country twist. And then the Dream Syndicate formed, which we, of course, loved. And that early iteration was amazing. It was great. So yeah, it was very, very incestuous, the way all that stuff worked back then. Everybody knew each other, you know?
We're definitely fans of that scene.
I know, it's great. You guys are really supportive.
We love it. So, Greg, we wanted to ask you if there was anything else that you wanted our listeners to know about the new record before we let you go.
Well, first of all, I want to thank you for taking the time to talk to me and to care about the Long Ryders, because, you know, it's a long time ago, and we feel grateful when people want to still hear our music and support us. And I think that I just want to say that Psychedelic Country Soul, I mean, the name, it really just came about because it's just three things that matter to us. We've all loved Southern soul music and country music and psychedelic. It speaks for itself, and it caught a moment in time. And, you know, these are the songs we wrote together. It really started out as a love letter to each other, because we do care about each other a lot. We've known each other 35 years off and on.
Wow.
And for us to make this record, we had no idea if anybody would like it or want to put it out, or if we didn't know anything other than we felt like we owed it to each other to get back together and see what we could do, even if we just ended up having a recording of 10 days together, four old friends, five, you know, with Ed. And it turned into something a little bit more exciting than we expected. And I said, you know what, this is something we want to share with our friends and fans and remind people to connect the dots from that sort of cosmic through line from, you know, the Everly Brothers, you know, to Chuck Berry, and then to the Birds and the Burritos, and, you know, right on through people like us and into the newer groups, whether it's the, you know, at Jayhawks back when we were around, and Wilco, and now, you know, the Jason Isbell and Marco Price, all that stuff, Tyler Childers, it's just all one cosmic line of music. So we just thought we'd remind everybody that this is one of the estuaries from that sort of cosmic river. And it's really important to us that our fans have a good experience, enjoy it, and know how much it meant to us making it. And the rest of it's sort of up to whatever, man. But we're pretty happy.
Well, just speaking as a fan, Greg, we want to thank you, Jeff and I and our listeners. We want to thank you for sharing this love letter with all of us and letting us hear new music. And we're just excited for you guys, and we're excited for this tour.
Yes, we
so
are.
So we'll be waiting for that announcement. But more than anything, Greg, thank you for sharing a part of your day with us and with our listeners. And cannot wait for February 15th to get here.
Yes.
Thank you both. We will see you at a show for sure. Come and be our special guest. And I do want to wish you all Psychedelic Country Soul until then.
Thank you so much, Greg.
All right. Bye-bye, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Soraya, I'm so excited for this record.
How fantastic is this? I mean, first of all, the two tracks that Greg very graciously shared with us, they're really solidly good. And they are, as he mentioned, they are true Long Ryders tracks.
Yes. Yeah.
So if you're a fan of the band, you're going to really enjoy. I mean, Greenville is it's a good song. It's a poignant song.
Yep, absolutely.
Then Molly Somebody is just, I mean, it's a blast.
Yes.
It's okay. A really, really cool rockin' tune. And that's so neat that Sid and Stephen from Translator.
Yeah. Yeah.
Worked on that. I'm telling you, Jeff. Now, I'm just amazed at how songs get written and produced when people are all over the place.
Yeah.
Technology makes things a lot easier.
Yeah. There's a lot that can be said about our turbulent times, but one thing that we have that's working for us is definitely technology and being able to connect. And
think about it.
Yeah.
Think about it. Sid's in the UK. Greg is here in LA. Tom is back east. So is Steven. I mean, wow. It's just, you know those moments where you hear something and something just gives you that little extra energy? Man, that was that today.
Yeah. And
yay, Greg.
Yeah, he was great, wasn't he?
I like talking to him. Yeah. So easy.
Very cool, dude. Well, so for today, that wraps up this episode. As always, we can be found on Facebook, Instagram, Podbean, iTunes.
Twitter.
Yes, yeah, so if anybody wants to get in touch with us, those are ways that you can get in touch with us, please listen, continue to listen to the podcast, subscribe on those outlets, and we've got some very exciting shows coming up that are starting to line up.
100%. So stay tuned.
Yes.
But most of all, make a note of it. February 15th, Psychedelic Country Soul.
You can pre-order now.
Woohoo!
All right, Soraya.
So, without further ado, gente, a rubiar.
Groove on, Paisley people. Psychedelic. Bye-bye.
Most of our music is just gut feeling. We're trying to make music with integrity instead of music that this last 6 months.
Now coast to coast and town to town, do what you gotta and the work is around. What could be better than to be right here where you see what you mean and Miller's so dear. Miller's made the American way. What you do and what you
say. You don't have to be the best musician in the world. You just have to mean it.